All right, I'm sure that since Sunday, everybody's probably been through a certain amount of tribulation and been through some things that you feel like laying down and just dying. but we ain't gonna let you. So put your hands out. Come on, everything that just bothering you. All right, there you go. I like that. Get it out of your shoes. Get it off. It ain't no need to worry about it. The Bible says don't worry about anything, but pray about everything, and the peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep your heart. And what? Keep your heart and mind at rest as you trust in Him. Come on. All right, put yourself there too. That's your biggest problem. Whoop. Come on, here we go. Ready? Go. One, two, three. Woo, boy, I'm glad to get myself off my back. See, you got to talk to yourself like that. I love that prayer. God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I can't change and give me the courage to change the things I can, and then the wisdom to know the difference. Remember that. Hey, Rachel. Good to see you. You got one of these? Yeah, we'll get one to you. All right, we've been talking about, okay, let's go with it. Here we go. We've been talking about the body of Christ. All of us are members. The reason that we are members in the body of Christ, that we've all been baptized by the one Spirit into the body of Christ. That's one baptism right there. Okay, we're not talking about baptism of water. We're not talking about baptizing the Holy Ghost. We're talking about the one Spirit when we accepted Christ. That's why you don't vote anybody into the church. You welcome them into the church. You accept them into the church. That's what the Bible teaches. And, of course, a lot of churches, we won't go that way, but I'm preaching the gospel, so you just have to look it up for yourself. But we are baptized into the body of Christ. Whether you like it or not, yes, I'm your pastor. Yes, that's the place that God has put me, but I'm your brother. And don't you forget it. And you, my sister, and my brother. And we all have the same Father. And we're going to live together throughout eternity. And someone said, oh, boy. So you might as well learn to love one another right now. God ain't going to have no division in His children. Amen. So, roughly, one of the things that we all want to make sure of, that we always keep the unity in the body of Christ. Every mother in here, every father, if you had 10 children, maybe you had one or two, you might not even, maybe three, is to keep the unity in that body, in your family. One kid may be pulling this way, next kid may be pulling that way, and you got to pull them together and say, no, we're going to love one another. We're going to respect one another. And we all are a part of this household, and we're all going to have certain jobs to do, and while we're doing it, we're going to keep the unity. Is that the way you taught your kids? That's the way we taught ours, right up front. No beckering. Now, sometimes, you know, I remember one time the kids, they must have been about five or six years old, and Susan just corrected them, you know, and explained all that to them about unity and keeping the peace, and your sisters hug one another, and you know, and all that. And so we get on the swing, see, and they get back into it again. Let's see how they work this out. And they worked it out. I felt, oh, that's great. They're learning to work it out themselves. So sometimes you might see people, Bob, why don't you do something? Let's just see if there's any growth in those two women and see if they can't get together and love one another. Because men don't have that problem, you know. But mostly, usually it's the two women, you know. It's in the Bible, by the way. You know, I only say what the Bible says. That's right. It's in the Bible. Paul says, those two women that work with me so good, you know, help them to love each other, keep the peace. Everybody's ever read that in the Bible? There's one, two, you've read it. Okay. So, but there's times that we have those things, and it doesn't mean the end of the world. It's just that sometimes we just let the flesh get a little bit, out there in front, and we have to bring it back. All right, but here we see, everybody have their paper, the unity in the body of Christ, and you'll read this all through the scriptures. All through the scriptures you will see unity, 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 unity. Keep the unity in the bond of trouble. What? Keep the what? Unity in the bond of what? Peace. In the bond of peace. Now here we have, now remember, God, the reason you're here is God has put you in this body. God has baptized us into a body that we love one another, and this is how we grow, because we rub against each other. And that ain't all bad, because see, whatever's in you, would you volunteer? Thank you. I love a volunteer, don't you? You know, some folks you just have to drag up, you know, but he volunteered. You know. See, I may rub up against him a little bit, you know. Let's see what's inside of him. Oh, but excuse me. Boy, when you go off, boy, how many of you know him rubbing up against me? Rubs that little something up that needs to come to the surface where you can deal with it. Yeah. Come on, church. You know, if you don't know what's inside of you, but God has put us together, and we will. Has anybody ever rubbed up against anybody in here? I didn't need to ask that question. I know it. You know. All right. All right, but say unity. Unity. Unity in the body of Christ, in the bond of peace, okay? Now, we're brothers and sisters whether we like it or not. There's neither male nor female, Jew or Greek. We're all one man. See, and I'm saying this not, I've been around a long time, but I love all of God's people, but the church is split into 25,000 different pieces. How many know that? Okay. We know that. But God grant me the serenity to accept the things I can't change. But at least I can teach those that God has put under my care the way the Bible teaches it. Okay? So, I don't care if they're Baptists, Methodists, if they've been born again, they are my sister and brothers in the Lord. And yes, they may have different doctrines, but if they're born again, they're born again and God did it. God birthed them into the kingdom of God. So I can't vote them out. You follow me? Now look at this, you see. Fivefold ministry. God initiated this. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Okay. Now I'm not going to cover that tonight, but you see that in Ephesians 4, 1 through 16, about these fivefold ministries. Okay, now let me just say something. Actually, it's four. Pastor and teacher is about the same thing, okay? But we do have anointed teachers. Now, that's sort of a controversial thing in the body of Christ, so just put that on your shelf, because if a pastor is able to teach, okay, instruct and teach the Word of God. All right, then you have your motivation gifts. That's found in Romans 12, 1 through 12. You see that? Prophecy, serving. Some of you will see your gift in there. Teaching, exhorting, giving, ruleth, and mercy. There's seven of them. Then your manifestations of the Spirit, which we are going to talk about tonight. The word of wisdom, the word of knowledge, faith, gifts of healing, workings of miracles, prophecy, discerning of spirits, different kinds of tongues, and interpretation of tongues. So that's where we're going to go tonight, and we're going to go into 1 Corinthians chapter 12, start with verse 1. And this whole chapter, I hope we can get through it tonight and learn something in it. But just remember, whatever gift we may have, we don't have anything to brag about. God has given us eternal life. He's given us his righteousness. He's given us these gifts to function within the body of Christ. But not only in the house of God, but as we go out into the family, I thank God that the gifts of discernment has worked into me, that God has given me that spirit for a pastor, but also for a father at home. I could discern when my kids are telling a lie. I could tell them when they weren't Jesus-like. How many could tell that? See, so remember, in the body of Christ, but in our local homes, okay? Also, and then on the job, you're going to learn people. And people are going to rub up against you. It's called rubby-dubby-dub. they will rub up against you and you will feel like sending them to the moon. But you don't do that. You bless them, you forgive them. You do not, the Bible says, overcome evil with evil. No. Why? I said, what's that? Why? Overcome evil with good. Romans what? 12, 21. All right, here we go. Now about spiritual gifts, there it's on the board. The special endowment of supernatural energy, brethren, I do not want you to be misinformed or ignorant. King James says. Now notice there are supernatural gifts. All right, you got a supernatural gift. Let's say you got a supernatural gift. I don't have any. So I'm jealous of you. For what? God gave it to him. Why should I be jealous of something that God gave to my brother or my brother over here? Whatever he's given to me. So we don't want his gift. We don't want his gift. We want to operate in our gift. Yes. Everybody understand what I'm talking about? I'm saying that for a reason. Because I've seen people try to edge people out of the body of Christ through gossip and just destroying their character by their tongue. Okay, I got to tell it like it is. Is that what you want me to do, or you want to hear a bunch of lies? Okay, now, I praise God that we have a good fellowship here. I don't see anything like that going on. But I have, and I pray I know how to handle it. Okay, now, I don't want you to be, but you know that when you were heathens, all right, now, next verse. You know that when you were heathen, I beg your pardon, Paul, I was never a heathen. He's calling us heathen. Did you hear that? Okay, heathen, you were led after idols that could not speak, habitly as impulse directed, and whenever the occasion might arise. So the heathens were worship idols. They thought these idols were really gods and had power, and they went after them and one thing and another. So he's making a little distinction here between how God works and how idols are and how the devil works and all of that, using those idols to bind people. Go to the next verse. Therefore, I want you to understand. Everybody say understand. We need understanding. Get wisdom, but in all thy getting, get. I didn't hear you. Get. We have to understand the word of God and understand one another, understand the principles of God to operate as his body. Understand that no one speaking under the power and influence of the Holy Spirit of God can ever say, Jesus be cursed. So if somebody gets up in the church and they start cursing Jesus, what spirit? You know that is not the Spirit of God. Say, Jesus be cursed. And no one can really say Jesus is my Lord. Now catch this. Except by and under the power and influence of the Holy Spirit. When I share the plan of salvation with somebody, I totally trust the Holy Spirit to cause them to believe, to trust, and to speak. Because they can only do that and really mean it by the influence and the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, yesterday, Susan and me went and stopped by a Dollar Tree and bought some trees. I mean, we stopped by Dollar Tree, and this young girl was in there, and she worked in there. And when Susan, of course, Susan has to, see, there's only about 1,000 of these sympathy cards and all, you know. And Susan thinks she's got to read every one of them. My hair falls out. And she said, Daddy, what do you think? Oh, this is a good one. I can pick them out by discernment. Take this one, this one. Listen, people, they don't read those things. You don't read those cards. What you're looking for is any money in this thing. Come on, don't lie to me. Listen, I've just tried to loosen you up just a little bit. But I think there was two, you could get two for a dollar. I said, man, get 50 of them, because she sends them out all the time. And anyway, so we picked some out and everything, and I encouraged, I said, that's good. But this young lady was working in there. To make a long story short, God allowed us to win her to Christ. She's about 23, 24 years old. Amen. I give God the praise. But we're doing this all the time now. And the reason I'm bringing that up, just hold that picture. We went by belt. Susan wanted to get me, since we're going to this graduation, you always have to have a new suit. I said, what's for what? I don't need a new suit. I need a new bulldozer. New saw. Weed eater. Lawnmower. Well, she couldn't find one anyway. But I said, honey, you go ahead and look. I'm going out to the car. I'll get in the car and I read, you know, Generations to Revelation. Then she finally shows up. I've read the whole Bible. Then I start preaching to her and teaching her. I just get. But I do read a lot in my car, because Susan likes to shoppy shoppy. And I enjoy taking her. I'm not complaining. I'm just opening my life. This is it. This, you know, get a little idea of what we do sometimes. But anyway, so I'm in belts now, and this man comes in, and I said, hey, I got a question for you. He said, yeah. I said, you know, I told him about a few of my jokes, and he laughed. He said, that was good. He said, I said, have you had your vitamin pill yet? And I give him a track. He looked at it. Oh, and then I said, I looked at him. I said, you're a Christian, aren't you? Yes, I am. And let me tell you my experience. Oh, I said, I want to hear it. He was walking down New York Street sidewalk, about 20-some years old. He was about 50-something now. He didn't know nothing about God. He's just doing his thing. And this old, this woman that was a homeless woman was saying something. Do you know him? Do you know him? Do you know him? And the Holy Ghost hit him. He started crying and weeping, and God saved him right on the street. With that old woman says, do you know him? Do you know him? I want to tell you something about the Lord tonight. He'll seek you out and he'll find you. He's the reason why you're here tonight. He called you into a holy calling. He did it. Come on, we got to see what the Lord is doing. I tell you, some folks don't understand that God is not dead. He's alive. You read these stories in the Bible about the Apostle Paul. Oh, Paul was looking for the Lord. He was running. God struck him down. Hallelujah. Right out there on the dew desert.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You read those accounts. Philip. Can you see? We look at it from the apostle side, maybe, or Philip's side. But you take the man that was in the chariot, the eunuch, going to Ethiopia. Remember that? He's in the chariot. God takes Philip. Philip, I know you're in revival right now. Brings him over, sets him down in the boondocks. And the eunuch is in the chair trying to figure out, what in the world is this guy talking about? Isaiah, what is he talking? Is he talking about? And Philip is right there. And God is right there. Okay? And we read the story from Philip's side, but I'm going to tell you about the side of the eunuch. Let's see what he goes back and he tells his family, listen, I was riding in the desert, and this man was running beside the chariot. And I looked, and the man said, what are you reading? He said, well, I'm reading somebody. Do you understand? No, how can I understand unless somebody tells me? And Philip gets up in the chariot and explains about Isaiah, which is Christ died on the cross. And one thing to another, they say, no, the guy's in the water. He's baptized, and Philip disappears. Listen, that's God. Say, God. God. Quit worrying about it. It's God. It's God. I am so convinced of it. Everywhere I see in the scripture, it's God. It's God. It's God. It's God. It's God. It's God. It's God in you. It's God directing your life. It's God. I don't need to shout, but I'm telling you, I'm excited about it. Revival's here. Give me five. Thank you. Glory to God. It's God. The reason that young lady was, I mean, think about it. She goes to work. She has no idea of being sick. Now, on our side, Susan would be sniffing them out. Did you take your vitamin pill yet today? Oh, you ain't going to get my vitamin pill. We give them out freely. We have received freely. We give. God knew that woman was going to save that day. From the foundation of the world, God chose that young lady to be His. I know you got some kids that you figure ain't nobody. You're right, ain't nobody going to reach them. But I know somebody can reach them in the middle of the night, in the hospital bed, in prison. Boy, when I read these stories in the Bible and I realize, it ain't Peter, it's God. It ain't Paul, it's God. It ain't you, it's God. It ain't me, it's God. But praise God, we're willing for Him to use us. It's God. Whew. And if God be for you, who can be against you? And if God be for you, who do you cares against you? See, you get free that way. Yes. When you understand and comprehend the things of God. Well, let's move on here, because all in this, you're going to see that it is God. All right, let's go to the next one. Now, there are distinctive varieties and distributions of endowment. What does he mean by that? Different endowments. This young man's got a certain endowment. This young man's got elderly man's got a certain endowment. This young lady's got a certain, all of us have certain distinctive varieties and distribution of endowment, gifts, extraordinary power, which comes from God, notice from God, distinguishing certain Christians. So it ain't going to need for us to say, well, I want what you got. No. God distributes those. God distributes the endowment to certain people. The reason Linda can lead the singing, God. It ain't about Linda. It's God. This young man can preach. It ain't about it. It's God that's giving him that. And see, we got to see that. And we just say, oh, thank you, Father. I just pray for my brother. Pray for my sister. It's God that enables us. Look at gifts, extraordinary powers, distinguishing certain Christians due to the power of their might. Hmm? What? Oh, I read that wrong. I appreciate correcting me. Due to the power of divine grace operating in their souls by the Holy Spirit. Now, let's make sure we understand that. You're sitting there, and this sister's getting up, or this brother, and it seems like, man, glory to God, and you're looking at that. Man, you get jealous. I've seen it. Anybody ever seen it? Anybody ever experienced it? You wouldn't tell on yourself, would you? But you'd tell on your neighbor. Huh? Now hear what I'm saying. What I'm saying, this is important that we understand this. Look what it says. Distinguishing certain Christians due to the power of divine grace. Have you ever seen somebody trying to operate in a position in the church and the grace of God is not on the person, God has not called them, and they're faking it? They can only fake it for so long because they'll play out. I've seen it. See, I've been in this thing almost for close to 60 years. I think I've been in every situation in a church setting that you can imagine. But I learned, and I read the Bible. Operating in their souls by the Holy Spirit, and they vary, but the Holy Spirit remains the same. Same Holy Spirit. Understand that, and you'll free yourself. Just whatever endowment the Holy Spirit endows any one of us, just thank God. Because you see, we're all one body. And the reason that I have the endowment is to help you. The reason you have the endowment in your gift is to help me, that the whole body would be strengthened. Do we understand that? Okay, very important. Now look what it said. Let's go to the next verse. And I can say a lot more, but time element. Oh, it's five after almost. And there are distinctive varieties of service. I watched all the different people in their service to the Lord. And I mean, it's cleaning the building. It's bringing food at home. You're cooking. You bring food. You bring it back there and you feed the body of Christ. What an honor it is for you women to feed the body of Christ. Because the Bible talks a lot about fellowship. And if you really read the Bible like I have over and over and over and over and over, and then you go back over and over again, and you read it over and over again, and you're reading this translation, you begin to understand what God is doing. Notice what it says. Different service. And I could point out different people that are different. And sometimes we may have the same service that Sister So-and-so or Brother So-and-so. And that's fine. You don't fight over it. You serve together. This is so delicate when people are hurt and wounded. It's hard for them to blend together. And you're strong. You're the muscles and the bones and that keeps this body together. Because there are people that are so hurt and wounded, if you say boo to them, they get, oh, oh. Then you don't see them for a month or two. And then I say, Susan, have you called her yet? You know, if you don't see them, call them, find out, let them know you love them. They got offended. You were vacuuming, and they take the vacuum and clean it away from you. Well, they won't have to struggle much with me. Oh, my goodness. How many understand what I'm talking about? You're washing the dishes, you know, and they're washing, and you come up, I'm just going to help them, and they, gosh, I hadn't seen her about a month. How many understand what I'm talking about? I mean, you got some people. I can tell some of you. I can see your eyes. Yeah, you. But we love them. We understand that's a hurt person. Okay? It's a hurt person. Now, and there are distinctive varieties of service and ministration, but it is the same Lord who is served. We ain't trying to outshine one another. Wrong attitude. That's the world's attitude. And if we're not careful, we've all been out there in the world working, and you know it yourself. You're trying to outshine John. John's out trying to outshine you. You're trying to get points with the boss. You bring him cakes and cookies. Invite him out for dinner. Is that what the world does? Yeah, that's what the world does. Called brownie points. And if you're in leadership, watch out. There'll be people in the church trying to get brownie points. Take your hand out of the cookie jar. I love you. Don't have to do that. I love you if you don't do nothing. But thank God we got people that can do some things. Amen. I get excited about that. So I'm bringing this thing down where we can understand it. And you might understand some of your feelings and some of your past conduct. And I've seen it, but I loved you and I prayed, and boy, you're doing good. I'm proud of you. Look what it says. And there are distinctive varieties of service. And there's a lot I can say about that. And ministration. But it is the same Lord who is served. Yeah. It is the Lord that we serve. Yes, sir. Remember that. All right, go to the next verse real quick. We had to move fast. Notice it's God, God, God. So far, it's all God, isn't it? Huh? It's God. And there are distinctive varieties of operation, of working to accomplish things. Well, this is the way we do it. We've always done it. Well, I want to tell you something. There's different ways you can do certain things. Hello? And there are distinctive varieties of operation of working to accomplish things. But it is the same God who inspires and energizes them all in all. See, it's God again. Every verse, it's God, God, God. I would just say God. The reason you have what you have is God. The reason you're so pretty, it's God. The reason I'm so good looking, it's God. Everybody say God.
God.
Now, this gets exciting. Notice who inspires and energizes them all in all. All right, let's go to the next verse here. But to each one is given the manifestation of the Holy Spirit by that individual desire. No. The evidence, the spiritual illumination of the Spirit for good and profit, not for himself, but for the whole body. It's always for the whole body, for the good of the whole body. Everybody say for the good. Of the whole body. See, as leaders, and I'm saying this to our leaders, we have to be conscious of that. This man's been called a minister. Young lady back there called as a minister. Not for their good, for the good of the whole church. All of you that have gifts. Missy's not back there for her own thing. No, it's for the good of the whole body. God's body that he lives in. God's children. For each one, put your name in there. Is given the manifestation of the Holy Spirit. Why can Doris preach? Why can Willie preach? Why can Frank preach? Why can Willie preach? Why can I preach and teach? God. It's God. Ain't no to have no jealousy. It's God. It's God. It's God. So you have to burn that old worldly competition insecurity out of our beings and realize God gives us the energy. God gives us the gift. God gives us what we need to serve. Not to benefit our own self, even though it does benefit us ourselves, but for the whole body. The evidence, the spiritual illumination of the Spirit for good and for profit. Next verse, 8. To one is given in and through the Holy Spirit. Notice God, God, the Holy Spirit, the power to speak. Oh, if I could just speak as good as you. Oh, man, if I could speak as good as you. Well, I could if God gave it to me. The reason he can speak so good God has given it to you. Hello, are you out there?
Yes.
Ain't no need for me to desire what he's got. God has given. If God sees fit, he'll give it to me or you. Do you know what it is to be king? Do you know what it is to be in charge? Do you really want to be in charge? Can I tell you what you can expect? I don't want to level you tonight. I want you to learn. I've seen this, people fighting for that position. They don't even know what it is to be the pastor. They don't know what it is to be in charge of that particular woman group. You want to take Missy's place back there? So anybody want to volunteer? I never see people fighting for the nursery. I mean, Susan is the most secure person in her position. Ain't nobody wants her job, and we've been looking for it for years. But Susan, see, God has given her that supernatural energy to love those children and teach them the Word of God in the nursery. Why, before they get out of the crib, they're quoting John 3:16. Preach better than I can. If thou wilt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, soul winners right in the crib. Powerful what those young people know. Now, look what it says. The power to speak a message of wisdom, and to another the power to express a word of knowledge and understanding according to the same Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit. I want you, all through that chapter, we're not going to get through it all the time. It's God, it's God, it's God, it's God, it's God. And wherever, whatever, where God's put you, just say, thank you, Jesus, that I don't have Pastor Bob's job or Frank's job or Rick's job or Missy's job or somebody else's job. We got a man here that welcomes people. When they walk in that door, they see a smiling face. You know, you're walking, here's this guy. You got to watch, you can scare some of them away, you know. You know, we're so full of love, we just want to give it away. All right. To one is given in and through the Holy Spirit the power to speak. Boy, if I could just speak like Billy Graham. That's what I want. Yeah, you want Billy Graham's position? You know, he's got these giant demons that chew on him every day. See, you don't understand. The higher God brings you up, that's why you got to learn here that when He puts you up here, you can stand the pressure of the enemy. And you ever seen somebody? The enemy, I'd be, God, come, huh? And He's trying to teach you to do spiritual warfare. Our weapons are mighty through God to the tearing down of strongholds. Our weapons are mighty through God. They're not flesh and blood weapons. They are mighty through God. Mighty through God. Mighty through God. There's God again. Mighty through God. Everybody say, it's God.
It's God.
You might as well say it now. It's God.
It's God.
So when you see somebody up here singing as good as I can, amazing grace, how sweet. And everybody said, boy, Lord, I think he's missed his calling. I don't see the Holy Ghost there at all. Huh? Yeah, you know, but you know, out of my heart sometimes, I dare to do that, you know. But the Holy Spirit is the one that anoints. Linda, she fixes the cake up. Frank don't like cake. So she makes her cakes up and she gives them to me. And they're going like that. They don't hit the table at the house. Justine makes cakes. All of these girls make cakes. But they don't last long around me. And him. And a few other people around here. All right. We ain't got going here, but we're going to do our best. All right. So notice the power to express. If you don't have it, don't worry about it. God still loves you. God still loves you. If you don't sit there, but just listen to me and smile, you're fulfilling your. I mean, just to sit there and listen to me, there's got to be grace upon grace upon you. Look, speak the message of wisdom and to another the power. Now, these gifts can be exercised not only in the church setting, but in our homes. Okay, to our children, to our loved ones. God will give you a word of knowledge. It's not like you have the gift and you can use it 24/7. It ain't like that. It's just that when your heart is tuned, God gives the gift at that moment. I remember when I had the gift of faith. That time I went up and this man said my nephew was driving his motorcycle and he had a wreck on Highway 52 and he went rolled down the Highway 52 and he was one big mess. You ever went out there and rubbed that pavement? You just rub that pavement sometimes. Just sit there, take time, rub it. It's rough. So they call. Yeah, I come down. You know, I'm going. Sometimes I go down there. I said, well, what have I got? I ain't got nothing. If God don't give me something, I ain't got nothing. If God don't give you anything, you ain't got nothing. It's God. But to perform my duty as a pastor, as a minister, I went down there. And God gave me faith. And I went in there, and I went into the hospital, and I said, where's he at? He said, well, they're bringing him in now. And I said, don't worry, he ain't going to die, he's going to live. And I hadn't even seen the man, but I had faith. God gave me the faith. I had nothing to brag about. God gave me the faith. And they directed me down there, and they had him in there, and they was cutting his clothes off, his blood and tar, just a big mess. And they said, the preacher's here. They all backed up. I come in. I said, you won't die. You want to live in Jesus' name. I back up, and they come in, start cutting their clothes off again. And guess what? He lived. I can't take no credit for it. But God, at that moment, it ain't my gift, it ain't your gift, it's God's gift, and he furnishes the power for you to operate in that gift. And if he does it, you just learn to cover up. You know, you just speak in tongues where nobody can understand you or something like that. You fake it. How many of you have ever faked it? Don't lie to me. Yes, you faked it. Everyone has faked it at times. You didn't mean to. You probably didn't even know it, but I know it. Do you love him? You love that guy? Oh, yeah, I love him. I'd not wait. He'd be living on the moon 24/7. But that's part of the human element, and you know how to deal with it. You put it off. Now, look. Okay, here we go. Now, notice this. Knowledge and understanding according to the what? God seems to get into all these verses. Have you noticed that? Every one of these verses, it's God using folks like us to carry on his work according to the same Holy Spirit. Next verse. To another wonder working faith by the same Holy Spirit, to another extraordinary power of healing by his effort. By what? Holy Spirit, God, 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 God. Everybody say, God, come on. God, 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 God. All through that chapter, it's God, God, God. It is God in your life. The reason you can do what you're doing, it's God, it's God, it's God. And our job, my job, your job is obey. Yes, there's times you're going to feel tired. There's going to be time when your emotions feel like if you could just go over there and die for about 24/7, then come back to life again and maybe start over again. It ain't that way. In season and out of season, you go in the name of the Lord. You trust him to provide life. I live and move and have my being because of him. The spirit of life, or the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus, has set us free from my bad looks. Let me say that again. The law of the spirit has set us free from the law of sin and death. Who has set you free from the law of sin and death? Holy Spirit. So all we can do is say, thank you, Lord. Lord, if I could just get better. You ain't going to get no better. Listen to me now. It ain't about you getting better. It's about how better he is in you.
Yes. That's good.
Come on, church. It's Christ in you, your only hope of glory. You live and move and have your being in Him. Bob, aren't you scared you're going to die at 84, 85? No, I'm not scared. I ain't going to never die. Jesus said, he that believeth in Christ will shall never die. Oh, this old body may lay down. I mean, I don't want to take it to heaven with me. In fact, I'll give it to anybody who wants it. Probably have to try to get away from Susan first. But once they put me in the ground out there, if you want, you can dig me up. For what reason? Stand me up in the corner. I told Susan, you know, if I do die, you know, just put me in the rocking chair and let the checks keep coming in to Social Security. You haven't thought of that, did you? Yes, you did. You thought... Well, there are people, you know, Roy Rogers, they stuffed the Trigger. Remember Trigger? Yeah, they stuffed him, you know. I think I look right good stuffed, don't you? It's one thing about Brother Bob, since you stuffed him, he don't say a word. And it's been a blessing to all of us, I'm telling you right now. Come on, I'm trying to loosen you. See, there's different ways of loosening people up. Don't you feel better since you come? You feel better, don't you? Yeah, you feel better. But I'm speaking truth. It's God. By the one Spirit. Next verse. Woo! Time's going by, but we're going to do our best. When I studied this chapter, I got so excited. It's God, 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 God. To another, the working of miracles. Do you realize if one person in here, God says, I'm going to pick one of you to work a miracle. And he works the miracle. You know, somebody comes up, they got a leg that's broken and twisted and everything, and you come up, you lay your hands on him, and boop, hallelujah, healed like that. He's just running around a bit. He's running around like this, and you go, it's me. Brother, can I tell you something? It's God. God chose you because you probably showed some degree of obedience and realized you wouldn't walk away from this place with a big head and you wouldn't think you're something on the stick, because God used you for God to heal the man. Notice. Peter and John coming to the temple. Man there, sitting down there, been there for all those years. Notice this. Arms, got his arms, dollar bills, $10, 20s, hundreds, arms. And Peter said, and John said, I ain't got nothing. Silver and gold, I have none. But such as I have, I give to you in the name of Jesus. Such, where'd you get it, Peter? From God. Rise up and walk. And the man got up and walked and jumped and went jumping and leaping and praising God. Leaping and jumping and praising God. For Peter caused him to walk and get healed. No, Peter, you didn't. It was God. And everybody in the place just thought it was great. And they took Peter and John and had a party for them and blessed them and gave them gifts and everything. Or did they go to jail for that? So after a while, when you read the Bible, you say, Lord, choose my brother. Push him out in front. Lord, use my brother. Come on, I'm speaking truth. So you got to see.
Yeah, I got your back.
How many looks at the computer? You have a computer. See, everybody got a computer. How many look at on the computer and you see, you know what they're calling all these men of God, Dollar, Brother Dollar, and every one of those men of God that's preaching, they call them devils. Yeah, that's what they got. Got it right on TV. These men are full of devils. So you want the power of God on you? You know, if you can't take just somebody saying, if you can't take that, how are you going to take when they come and carry you off and going to put you in prison? And feed you with possum stew. You follow me? If we don't understand these little things that come against us, because one day some big things are going to come up, because God's got a plan for every one of his children, and he wants to have vessels where his power can flow through. If you're satisfied with 110, be 110. We're not mocking that. These things are 110. But how about 220? Who wants to be a 220 Christian? Galatians. 220. Okay, I got you. Galatians 220. All right, I got you. Yeah, okay, okay, Lord, you see him. Okay, to another, the working of miracles, to another prophetic insight. You can determine the time, the prophetic. You just have understanding of it. I can't see that. But when you see, God gives you the gift. When he opens your brain, when he can show you, he shows it. You just know it. You just know it. You just know you're born again. You just know you love God. You just know that you're a child of the King. Because the Holy Spirit gives you the understanding, and you just know. It ain't some religious thing. You know by the Spirit of God. Look what it says. Insight, or the gift of interpreting the divine will and purpose. To another, the ability to discern and distinguish between the utterance of true spirits and false ones. As a pastor, I have that gift. I've seen people come in here, and it's just like my spirit just will not bear with them. I can't name it. It's just like, I say to the student, what is it? What is it? How many has ever discerned that? It's there. So we pray for them. We love them, accept them. We'll see. They don't stay long. God will just move them out. I've seen God move many people out. Many people out. Many people out. That's God. I pray. God has told me, he said, I was this one guy was causing, the Bible talks about those that cause division. Warn them once, warn them twice, have nothing more to do with them. That's how dangerous someone is that would create division in the body of Christ. Now, how many remember the scriptures in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17? Put it on the board. 1 Corinthians chapter 3. See, we need to understand this. This way, we will walk straight. How many of you remember this guy named, if it's in the book of Acts, Simon, his name was Simon. He saw the Holy Ghost, the people that Peter and John laid hands on these people, believers, and they received the gift of tongues and the Holy Ghost. How many remembers that in the Bible? And Simon first said he believed, and he says, give me that. He wanted to pay money, and I'll pay you money to give me that gift that whoever I lay my hands on, they can receive this gift. See, his heart was not right, because he was going to get money for it. And Peter said, okay, may thy money perish with you, my friend. You better pray to God to give you repentance, because God's going to be on your case. Okay, look what it says. If anyone does hurt to God's temple, I know that we don't like to hear, but see, I'm trying to save you. I'm trying to save the church. These people out there, because the church is really catching it from the news reporters, and they think we're just a bunch of, you know, they don't realize they ain't messing with us. They messing with God. Say, if anyone does hurt to God's temple or corrupts it with false doctrine or destroys it, God will do hurt to him and bring him to corruption of death and destroy him. So you see anybody, you don't want to be a partakers of that either. How many understand that? We need to understand that. If I didn't love you, I wouldn't show you that scripture. Because I've seen God take people out. See, that's the only thing about living as old as I am. I've been into faith for a pretty long time, and I've been around a long time, and I've seen God mess with me in this church, and he's out, gone. They're not alive anymore. I preach their funerals. And bring him to the corruption of death and destroy him, for the temple of God is holy. Where's the temple of God? Raise your hand. You holy. Don't mess with God's temple. For the temple of God is holy, sacred to him. We're sacred to him. And that temple, you, the believing church, and its individual believers are. So the church is going to have to get a new mentality of who we really are, and realize that God will give us the strength to walk in that daily and keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. And the time has run out. I hope we've learned something. I got plenty to share. Let's pray. Father, I thank you that you've given us enough for one night, but Lord, it's your love, it's your concern, and we see that it is God. It is God. It is God. And we thank you that whatever you have given to each and every one of us, we're satisfied with it and realize we've been chosen by the Holy Ghost to function in that for the good of the whole. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen.